Alors, je voudrais aborder la question des échelles
spatio-temporelles. I would like to discuss with you time and space scales, focusing on two stakes: introduction regarding sustainable development, education to sustainable development, evaluation of durability, and identification. One of the criticisms made regarding sustainable development vis-à-vis political decisions are the incapacity of decisions to depart from short-term provisional solutions, immediate reactivity to the expense of long-term organization projects. Sustainable development's ambition is to change the time focus of decision-making processes, and sustainable development is a principle to justify a sort of story, a narrative pattern to legitimate action. In order to consolidate this story, I'd like to go back to the year 2000 with a new discipline called sustainability science, which is an interdisciplinary science focusing on the understanding of interaction dynamics between human societies and natural systems, with the aim of sustainable development. In order to understand this, we need good knowledge of past systemic systems, and disciplines are involved, such as history, archaeology, geomorphology, and other such like sciences. Just to provide a concrete example and illustrate the ambition, we could analyze how durability assessment was made in the Loire Basin in France since the 80s. For 30 years, there has been a fight between a local association led by the Tours mayor called EPALA to a group of people in another group called Loire Vivante, the Living Loire. The idea was to build new dams after the Lansac and Villeray, four dams, in order to organize low flow periods to meet the needs of farmers, to deal with floods and develop nautical tourism. In the end, we all know how it ended. People fought the dam construction, and also nationally people became aware of environmental questions, and therefore the dams were abandoned except for Nosac. Some dams were even destroyed, existing ones, and other dams were reconfigured. And in 1994, the Loire Grandeur Nature Plan was adopted as a plan here, because Grandeur Nature in French means full size, but it also means nature. Now, we need to understand which arguments were used by the two main players. The EPALA project was based on modernization and obviously looking to the future with the continuous improvements in order to catch up with the existing delay versus other river valleys in France, which were more modern. And it was thought maybe that man could control for his own benefit all natural processes. Now, environmentalists reacted, saying that the Loire Valley was still wild and had to be kept that way, referring to the past, except they did not really understand that the river was no longer wild anyway when a number of infrastructures were built in the 20th century. Environmental archaeologists looked at older systems such as mills, mill streams, or even banks and embankments, which for some of them were very old, 10th century for some of them, and also the fact that they are closer or further away from the high grounds are closer or further away from the river. Here we have a plan showing that these high grounds have changed the bed of the river. In red, we have the current bed of the river constricted between the embankments and the high grounds versus the far wider bed it had in the past. But this has led to two consequences, obviously. The river flows faster because it is constricted. Also, the alluvial floor has in some places collapsed and dropped, probably due to the fact that banks and high grounds have been built along the river rather than the fact that granulates have been extracted from the floor. And finally, socially, the changes have also increased the feeling of safety of the people who felt themselves protected behind the high grounds, protected from floods, and actually still live there because urban planning has allowed houses to be built all along the riverbed. There are three phases: the phase of metamorphosis, the longest period of time, tens of thousands of years, the period during which the Loire Valley adopted its current configuration at the end of the second glaciation. Then the second phase is that of interactions, Neolithic until the beginning of our modern era, where people started living along the river. And the last period is the forcing period, when during the Middle Ages, the high grounds were built all along the river. During this period, the natural high grounds, the climatic high grounds, were the most important. And according to archaeologists, during the last two phases, entropic factors became more important for the hydrologic conditions of the river. Obviously, there were always interactions between the two types of forcings. During the small glaciation, 14th century, the increased rate of floods led societies to make adjustments to protect themselves from floods. The remaining question is the Loire the last wild river in Europe, as is often said, or a hybrid system which we have inherited as a legacy? And should we start thinking in terms of sustainability assessment? Is it relevant to continue maintaining dams and high grounds and banks for which we know that they may constitute a danger for populations? And also, we can wonder whether the doing nothing is the right solution, because there were hundreds of mills and mill streams that worked about 100 years ago and have stopped being maintained, and they were a very good barrier to protect the population from floods. Now, there is another path as an example. The interest for the World Heritage, we're talking about classification more than identification. This is something organized by UNESCO based on the idea that there is a heritage to be shared among humankind and that needs to be protected. Here we have the Sunanka tropical forest and the elephant that inhabit it, which have their own value, but also should be integrated in a world solidarity network. So there is both the identification on the local level and the world global level. Here we have the geographer Gratalou saying whether this global scale can be applied outside of the World Heritage Network. We're all prepared to share the heritage, but not necessarily the history associated with it. Another example is that of natural regional parks. Originally, these were designed as spaces to protect local territories, local areas. The idea was to protect a heritage, a local one. So it's not so much biodiversity controlled by scientists than an operation to protect a local heritage. Charters were written, and in the charters we see an evolution. The natural regional parks progressively also served as a basis for a more global thought. In the charters we now talk about world heritage and sustainability. I'll give you another very specific example, the way that salmons are dealt with in the project for a future national regional park in the Haut-Allier area. There is a species of salmons which is deeply rooted in the local heritage. It is also a source of income, obviously, locally, and also a species that is defended because of its brand image. And there are local players actually advertising the presence of the salmons in the river. And therefore, there is both a local value but also an international worth, because this type of salmon is considered as belonging to the world heritage. And there is obviously an articulation between the local and the global scale. In conclusion, we may remind that the scale level is absolutely essential when we talk about sustainable development and also education for sustainable development. There are possibly several directions for this education, identification. How can we develop global awareness? One of the slogans is act local, think global, and this is exactly a slogan that would apply here. But the existence of a world heritage is not sufficient. We also have to look at the history of societies, and usually these are limited to the national level. The third direction is to think not in terms of education for world developed sustainable development, but simply education to small actions, which can only be forwarded if the disciplines which tell stories and divide time in periods can get hold of them. Thank you.